Archive files are those locations where we store the actual process data. And don't let the word archive fool you into thinking this is something that's just for archival purposes, that we put this data there and then it's no longer available to people. By archive, what we're talking about is it's simply the location for where we're keeping your online data. Now, it does happen to be true that sometimes archives are taken offline, you know, after you've made a good backup of an archive, and maybe the data may be a couple of years old, you may not be interested in looking at it anymore. You can just let that archive be overwritten or remove the archive, and then it will not be available. But of course, you can always restore it later on. So let's take a look at what our archives look like if you look at some of our utilities. If you go into the System Management Tools, under Operation, you'll find Archive. And this is a list of the archives. As you can see, they're called PyArch.001, 2, 3, etc. And by default, we create three of them when we first install the system, but of course you can create more. And each of those is going to be associated with a particular start date and end date without any overlapping time. Let's take a look at an archive or a Py server that's got a little bit more information than this. I think what I'd like to do is switch over to a different server. Let's look at the server called Lorax. Yeah, there we go. That's the server. Now, I don't see this in the right sequence, so I'm going to scroll all the way over here. And you can barely see that, but if I can scroll all the way over, I'm going to sort this by its archive number. So we're starting with 0. That number is kind of a relative notation, where 0 is the most recent. And as you can see, archive 0 is the one with the most recent data. This is from September 26th to the current time. Now, archive 1, that's that relative number, which in this case has this name. As you can see, the naming convention does not really have anything to do with the sequence of the archive. But this archive right here, which, if we look at our sequence over here, is identified as archive 1. Here's 2, 3, 4, etc. Archive 1 is the one that's most recent to the current data, but not the current data. This is archive 0, this is archive 1, and this goes from August to September 26th. Archive 2 is the one before that. That's from July 10th to August the 9th. Now, it may not be obvious from this, but there should never be overlapping dates on any of these archives. So a way I like to draw it is, you know, imagine we've got a timeline that looks something like this. Here's our timeline from the start to the end of time, and we create archives to start storing data. Well, when you first create an archive, okay, we start to populate that archive. You know, when that becomes the archive that's currently getting data, we will populate that archive. And so this is the beginning of that archive period, and then this is when that archive's completely filled. That's the end of that period, and that's when we're going to shift, do what we call a shift, over to a different archive. So now we're going to be looking at a different archive. This might be PyArch 001, and this is PyArch 003. And with PyArch 003, now we're looking at this being the start time. And when that is indeed full, then we'll generate yet another archive. Now this is PyArch 002 or something like that. So essentially, as we move forward in time, these archives are not going to have overlapping data, I should say. Now, they're not all going to be the same duration and time, and that annoys some people. You know, they would like archives to be exactly 1 month long or 1 week long or something like that. But in fact, you know, the way this works is sometimes you have a month in which, or a week in which, you store a lot of data, in which case that archive, you know, they're all the same size, that archive's going to fill more quickly. And then some months you're not going to store as much data, in that case the archive doesn't fill as quickly. So that would be the start and the end of each archive. So in summary, as you look at the overall timeline, and if you look at the overall archive, those archives will not have overlapping dates. We put all the data for all the tags in the Py server into a single archive for a given range of time. If you're trying to write data to a Py tag that uses a timestamp, from something that's outside the ranges of these archives. So you can see this one starts on July the 10th, and it ends at the current time in October of 2007. So if we try to write outside that range, and there is no archive available that has those timestamps, you're going to run into a problem. You're basically going to be told that we cannot write that, that's beyond the range of the archives. That has implications, especially if you're doing some type of backfilling. If you want to write data in to one of these empty archives at a time previous to when we started writing data to Pi, there are some recovery procedures we can suggest you use to create archives that have the proper dates. But in general, if the dates of the that are existing in the archives, if the dates that you're trying to write to are not within that range of dates, then you're not going to be able to write to those archives. Yeah, that value is simply going to be discarded and an error will show up. Also, I should point out that this archive that's listed at the top, it's at the top simply because I've listed this in ascending order based on their number. If we look at this number right here, let me scroll that over again. Yeah, that number 0 through 6. This number is basically in the order in which we have written data, or in the case that the archives are empty, the order in which the archives were registered. So these values, or these archives right here, are in ascending order, and the zero archive is what we call the primary archive. As you can see, the status is termed primary, and that's where we normally write the current data. These archive files, they can go onto optical disk or off to a network drive. And that's fine, just as long as you make sure that anything that you're doing that's not on the local drive is made not what we call non-shiftable. One of the things you can do with this is to make something make an archive non-shiftable. And normally you'd only do that on an archive that has itself already shifted, so that it has data that is worth preserving in it. So yeah, any type of remote network or optical disk, a removable drive should be, if you're trying to access the data using those external media, then you should set that to non-shiftable so we don't try to shift on top of those archives. We'll talk more about that shifting algorithm in just a few minutes, or actually we'll talk about that when we talk about backing up the archives.